This season on Team Bachelor, there are 6 possible prom dates and 1 teen bachelor.
Kyle is like the only person I'm attracted to.
When I'm with him, I feel like a princess. My strategy is just to get as much time with Kyle as possible.
I think I love you. I think.
I just want to propose a toast to Kyle for being so gracious and giving us this amazing opportunity to find love.
It might be controversial, but a girl should be well-kept.
Meet Kyle, head of the lacrosse team and speech and debate captain.
You never know. I mean, I know that I'm 16 and she's 17, but, you know, I guess I kind of like older women, you know? Just so much freedom and experience.
I get butterflies every time I see him. I'm in love with him.
But Kyle can only choose one prom date.
It's like really hard seeing him with all the girls.
Hey, Huey. Hello.
What's going on in
there? Rose, I don't even like him. Oh my god. I guess we just need to die alone. Like, what?
I'm back.
Stop! Yeah, I can't! Stop!
At the end of the day, love wins. Kindness wins. And bringing people down never wins.
We're getting reports that a part of the tower, the second tower, the one a bit further to the south of us, has collapsed.
We are no way to accurately describe the emotion this evokes.
I hope I live. I hope I live. She's coming down on me.
September 11th, 2001 was an absolutely beautiful day. The skies were clear. The sky was blue, not a cloud in the sky. It was just a beautiful day to be outside. And because it was the end of what's called the fiscal year, which is the end of a budget year. So we were very busy closing out 2001 and starting 2002. So my office was very busy that day. I don't know how we knew. I guess somebody called somebody and they went to the room that had the television and turned it on. We had a senior executive in our suite, office suite. So he had a television, so they turned on the news. So we watched the recording of the first plane going in, and then we watched live the second plane going in. And we had people that would just walk in, watch it for a couple minutes and leave, or go back and forth. It just depended on, because we said we were very busy, so it wasn't like you could sit down there and stay half hour, 45 minutes watching television. The other supervisor had a pilot's license, and his comment was that there is no way in God's green earth that a commercial airliner gets that close to the World Trade Center. This was not an accident. I thought at that time maybe we should evacuate, but my office was full of type A personalities, which means they were very busy. And if I told them we have to leave, the first question they would ask me was, who said, why do we gotta go? We got work to do. It's just the kind of people I worked with. So we just kept working, and we naively thought that we would get some sort of warning. But there was none. Right before the plane crash, I was in my office. I was working on something. It had a deadline of 10 o'clock that morning. So I was working on that project, and I received a phone call from the other supervisor asking me to send someone to our new office so that he could be there while they're putting the alarm system in. So I got out of my desk, took a file with me. I took it to the next cubicle over, and I laid it on Patty's desk. And as I went to stand up, I heard a noise. And all I remember is my body going, do I tighten up or do I loosen? Because something's coming and it's not good. And if I had not gone back and picked up that folder, I would have turned and taken a step and gone face first into the blast. And then I heard the noise, and then the wind started, and then the heat started. And I'm not a small guy, and it picked me up and threw me in a fireball. The last conscious thought I had was, well, this is it. I thought I was a dead man. The next thing I know, I'm on the ground, kneeling and coughing, and I was covered in debris. As I batted some of the debris off me, the very first thing I did was look straight up and say thank you. And I looked down at my hands, and the skin on my fingertips and my palm had been pulled back. It's like if somebody had gotten a vegetable scraper and just pulled the skin all the way back to the ends of my palms and my fingertips. And I looked down and saw that, and I go, oh, that's not good. So when the plane came in, it punched a hole through the building, and it carried the debris field into our office, hence also a lot of bodies. The flight data recorder off the airplane was probably 35 feet away from me. Literally, when I say like a bomb went off in there, it was like that. Just, there was stuff everywhere. I mean, partition walls had broken apart and were laying on their sides or halfway against furniture and stuff. It was, when looking for the rest of my people, I got back into the room, and anything that was supposed to be like this was like this. Anything like this was like, everything was at the wrong angles. And there was just fire everywhere. And I knew at that time that no one was gonna come out of there. And I was right. Everybody who could get out alive did. There's only one person there's a question about, but he died. They all died pretty much immediately. Well, after I got everybody together, one of the things that surprised me was when I was younger, I was in the Navy. I worked in engineering. And in engineering, the first thing they teach you when you go into an engineering space is how to get out of there. It's just ingrained in us. So when I went to that new office, I've been there almost 3 years, I knew where all the fire doors were. I knew where all the escapes were. And I was the only one who knew where all the fire doors were. Nobody else knew where the fire doors were. Fire doors wouldn't do us any good because they were all blocked by furniture anyway. So I got everybody together, and then I went farther, deeper into the room towards the blast, looking for the rest of my guys. I guess because of the training, I always knew where I was in the room. I started heading towards our front door, and they had told me that it was all blocked. And when I got towards the end of the cubicle row, there was a wall, but I could see this little tunnel. It was, you know, like this tunnel, not a round tunnel, it was like an angled tunnel. And I looked at it and going, this is not a good time to get inside a tunnel and get stuck. So I got up on my knees and I realized I was up against the desk, and I could see the desktop, and I could see across the desktop. Invisibility was only a couple feet. So I crawled up on the desk, ended up wiggling my way around this desk till I came out the other side. And now here I am on top of this desk. How do you get off? So I had to go face first off the desk. And when I did that, I lost my shoe. And all I could think of is when I lost my shoe, I'll be like Bruce Willis in that movie when he's running around barefoot with all that broken glass. That's all I could think of was, I'm gonna find broken glass now, the way things are going. But when I came down, the front of our office had tile on it. Most of the office was carpet. I could see the tile, so I knew I was at the front of the office. So I stopped, looked, and in the haze, I could kind of make out this shape, which looked like a dumpster. Because we were moving, they had these old binders and whatnot. And I remember coming in that morning, and I pushed on the dumpster, and it was so heavy, I couldn't even push it. So I went, okay, that's where our front door is. And at that time, I could hear my guys, and I called back and forth to them, and they came to where I was. And when they got to the hole, they looked at the hole, and one girl goes, you know, I don't know if Paul could have got through that hole. And the other girl goes, get your skinny ass through that hole right now. So they all came through the hole, not through the top of the desk. And we went right out basically our front door. And our front door down a hallway, a corridor to the main hallway. And from there out, somebody helped me get there. And then I collapsed. And somebody brought me water. I was interviewed, triaged. An Army doctor looked at me. They put an IV in me. And then they said, another plane is coming. And that was flight, the one that crashed in Shanksville. So at that time, I didn't know it was a plane. But when they said another plane's coming, I kind of, okay, that was a plane. So they put us on these like golf cart things, which they use as ambulances. And they put a stretcher, put me on the golf cart, and got us out of the building. And they took us to where the child care center was. And then they moved us again to farther away because they're worried about more attacks on the Pentagon. At the time, the major injury was my lungs. They were pulling dead skin out of my mouth. They were sucking dead skin out of my lungs with pipettes. And the lung issue was the thing that was going to kill me. I was on life support for days. I was on a ventilator. You know, nowadays we all know about ventilators. Back then, I'd never even heard of a ventilator. They had IVs in me everywhere. They were trying to flush all the toxins out of my body. But the biggest injury at the time was the lungs. Everything else was secondary. There is no one at Walter Reed that thought I was going to get out of there alive. I was actually briefed to the Secretary of the Navy, the Army, Chief of Naval Operations, Army Chief of Staff, that I was going to die on Thursday, 2 days later. It turned out that the lungs was the biggest injury on 9/11, but afterwards it was the neurological damage that was the long lasting, the most impact for my life now. I mean, I lost hearing in my right ear. You remember that Star Wars movie where that guy has blood red eyes? That's what my eyes look like, just blood red. Apparently, overpressurization causes the capillaries or whatever in your eyeballs to burst, and they were just blood red. My hands were bandaged. My back looked like I'd been hit with a shotgun blast from all the debris. But all that was secondary to the lungs. The lungs is what was going to kill me. In fact, I firmly believe that if I had not been at Walter Reed, I'd been dead. Because they took such good care of me. They had to go against protocols to save me. I basically had an ICU nurse staring at me for 22 hours a day, 22 and a half. I can call up the events of that day with great detail. I don't. I keep them buried. I'm reminded of that day every single day. In that when I go to wash my hands, I look at the atrophy in my hands, how much damage there is. I wake up in pain. I go to sleep in pain. But I have a very great gift. When I got out of the hospital, went home, I called every family of those that died. And without exception, the first thing they said to me, they asked me how I was doing. And all I could think of was, these people just lost a loved one. And they're asking how I'm doing. And I think that drove a lot of my attitude. I realized those people would have been happy to have, no matter all the injuries I had, for the loved one to be alive. So the way I look at it was, yeah, it hurts. Yeah, I can't do the things I used to do. Yes, I'm in pain. But it's the price I pay for being alive. Because by rights, I should be dead. I never should have survived the blast. I never should have got out of that room alive. And I should have died at that hospital 2 days later with major organ failure.
Dear diary, I wish for a better pencil. One that wouldn't always break all the time and so hard to sharpen. Dang it! This always happens.
Theater of Brentwood High School, we give you Beauty and the Beast. This play follows the main characters of Belle, who is trying to live out her life as this odd girl who has an independent spirit with intelligence, and the Beast, who got put underneath an unbearable spell and focuses on his struggles to find his heart and his true love. There is one more person we need to recognize, and that being Miss Lisa Moody. She's been with Brentwood for the past 30 years, and she's been directing the musicals every year, and she's helped many people within the theater to do their best.
First, my experience has been lovely. I've been here for 32 and a half years. I don't think I would have stayed that long if it hadn't been a good experience. So I have loved being a mentor and seeing students succeed and being able to direct the shows and know that I've made a little impact in the lives of so many.
Over the Christmas break, David Moody, her husband, who's worked with her as a theater production teacher here at Brentwood High School, sadly passed away. And it was a shock to everyone, and especially the theater community.
Well, Mr. Moody built the set and really took care of the backstage and all of the behind the scenes things, so scenes things. So it has been difficult traversing, getting a set built and designed and trying to get his classes to work on projects and get things done while trying to do my job as well. So it has been a difficult 2 months. This last week was tough because we were trying to work the technical elements, and he usually is backstage working with stage crew so that I can be out front directing, and I was trying to do both, and it was very harried for me trying to do all of those things and get everybody ready. But we're making it, we're getting it through, and we're, as my saying for this season has been, it is what it is, you just do what you have to do.
Since the passing of Mr. Moody, things haven't been the same within the theater production room, with everyone carrying a bit of Mr. Moody's legacy with everything they've built. The theater community has been reliant on the students, parent volunteers, and teachers from around Williamson County to help out.
What? It appears I have melted. Mrs. Potts, if you please. Oh. The flames of love got to me.
Not only is this Miss Moody's last show, but it's also the senior's last show of the high school career, which makes every moment super special.
A lot of memories from all the shows that I've done over the years. Sort of all just coming back as we go through the whole show week and tech week process, remembering what it was like as a freshman, thinking I'd never be here, and now I'm here, and it's kind of crazy, but it's really fun, and I've really enjoyed this cast and just coming to rehearsal every day, getting to know everybody.
With the seniors leaving, the underclassmen have a huge hole to fill, and with a new teacher coming in, so does a new mindset.
As sad as it is to see Miss Moody go, I am excited to have, you know, a fresh perspective, maybe some new ideas in the department. Miss Moody herself has said several times that she is very excited for us to, you know, get a new experience with a different director. And it's not like she's completely abandoning us, so she's still gonna come help out with some stuff next year. So I look forward to next year with the new teacher.
I hope that the legacy that I've left behind is a positive one. I hope that people have looked at my performances and been able to smile. And I've hoped that I could show others what it means to be a performer and a leader. And I hope that I have done the best that I can to try and put a smile on other people's faces, because that's the goal of theater.
Well, we're really lucky with this cast. We have a great group of senior leaders this year. And I think it's very important, especially for the underclassmen, to, you know, they show everybody the ropes, and they've been teaching everybody and inspiring everybody to work harder and do better to make the show as great as it can be. And I'm really blessed to be friends with all of them. And I'm gonna be really sad when they give their senior speeches and they graduate.
She has done a countless many things. Over the past 4 years, 8 shows and 2 one-acts. It has been one of the greatest joys of my life to be involved with theater with Miss Moody.
Yes, I will be sad. I know there will be some grieving, but I think it's time for me to go. As much as I will miss it, we need someone in here who is younger and has more energy and can do the stuff that I've been doing for years and not be so tired.
As the show continues, we remember the Moodys and all of the work that everyone has put in. Beauty and the Beast has been a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Caleb Mealy, WBHS 9.